There have been polls conducted, Gallup polls, one poll called the Roper poll. The results were extrapolated and sent to over 150,000 American GPs, medical practitioners. They basically said it's almost at epidemic proportions. They estimate that up to 4 million Americans may have had an alien abduction experience, as they believe. And then you've really got to wonder, why is the nature of it so deceptive? You know, if they're really here to help us, as some of these contacts claim, you know, why do they go around acting deceptively? Why do they stealthily abduct people in the middle of the night? And, you know, when I say it was confronting, there was some subject matter that was particularly disturbing. You know, people claim they've been taken onto a spaceship and probed in all parts of their bodies. There are sexual encounters. There seems to be some sort of almost ritual abuse that's going on. So you've got to ask, why would advanced, you know, evolved creatures, you know, kidnap people in the middle of the night and do these horrible things to them, and yet say, you know, we're here to help you evolve? And it's interesting that, you know, we'd like to apply, if you like, a scientific tag to it, but quite simply, it seems that these creatures claim that they fly millions of light years across the universe to basically deny the Bible, Christianity, and teach us almost New Age beliefs. Why would advanced extraterrestrials come just to teach us religious messages? And it seems to me, and again the researchers will show you, that the messages being received are deceptive in nature. They will tell you things like, well, you know, we've come from Venus or Mars in the 60s, that was the messages. Well, we now know that's impossible. Now they say they come from Sirius or Orion or Zeta Reticuli or somewhere far off, where we can't test those claims. And that's the problem. And some of the stories they've told us, like that, we know to be demonstrably not true. And if someone comes to you, Chris, and tells you a story and does all these things and says, I'm here to help you, but then does brutal things to you and then lies to you, then I don't think trust is a good place to start. Let me just talk about abductions, because as I said, that's where I think we can unpick it. People that claim these abduction experiences say that little grey entities enter their room in the middle of the night and they see them pass through the walls, or they see them enter through the ceiling. And then these people who believe that they've had some real physical experience claim they're taken through the walls. Now, you and I know that can't be happening, but these people are having a real experience. But the question is it really aliens? Now, my conclusion there is I don't believe it is. All sorts of complex designs. These first appeared in the late 60s, I think early 70s, in the south of England. And they were a pretty simple design, and then they got more and more complex. And some of the hyperbole that's followed these, and you've heard some of this stuff, they are so precise and so exact, they could not have been man-made. The stalks have been bent in such a fashion, they've not been broken. We don't know any technology that can do that. There's leftover radiation. The cellular structure of the corn stalks or the wheat stalks or whatever it is have been changed. We've heard stories like that. But in the 1980s, two elderly gentlemen by the name of Doug Bauer and Dave Chorley stepped forward and claimed responsibility for all the crop circles that appeared, you know, in that early period. Now, they multiplied all over the world. So the first thing you need to realize, even though there are experts called seriologists, okay, serious field studies in this, that say that they're created by aliens, just average Joe Blows like you or me gathered that it could be made, and they started replicating it all around the world. And Doug and Dave, when they came out and took credit for them,
They were debunked. Here's how they make them. You can go to this website, circlemakers.org, and that's how they make them. Look at this, folks, a plank and two bits of rope. That is the most common and effective method used by people all over the world in making crop circles. However, there is a sinister side to it. And the circle makers, and again, look for yourself, you go to their website, their name originally was Team Satan. And you would wonder why somebody would call themselves Team Satan. I mean, they're in this for business now. Obviously, it was politically incorrect and they changed it. But why would a group of people call themselves Team Satan? Well, when you investigate their website, you'll see that they say when they build these crop circles, they have all sorts of paranormal experiences. People have had healings. There's been radio interruptions. Lights have appeared in the sky. And so they don't believe that it's UFOs. They just think it is some sort of psychic or paranormal experience. I mean, for example, people, I was in Canada recently, I turned on the sci-fi channel and there was a woman channeling a message from an alien being. And she was saying from this alien being that we've evolved to such a state that you couldn't see me. My atoms move so fast that if you were to pass your hand through my body, if you were to try to touch me, your hand would pass right through my body. And so people are dabbling in some sort of what they think is some sort of pseudo-technology when it's really opening a doorway to the occult.
Ahí se van a ver vientos. Y van a una velocidad, pero... 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 en la pantalla.
Síguelo, no lo cierres.
¿Están a la misma altura este Telles?
Afirmativo.
Poquito, arriba, arriba.
8, 9, 10, 11 contando toda la cola.
2,
4, 6, 8, 10, 11.
Ok, no sabemos qué estamos viendo, son unos objetos nada más luminosos que vienen a la misma altura que nosotros.
What you're seeing here has nothing to do with little green men from Mars, I assure you. Nothing to do with aliens. What you're looking at is the Vril 7. Matter of fact, we went over and got not only the V2 rockets, you know about all that, but we also got this technology right here, and we brought it back. Hitler had a whole series of these Vril saucers made. Now, this thing couldn't even leave Earth's atmosphere. It was not a flying saucer like you're thinking about. No little green men involved. We're talking about pure German science here, okay? And it really was just a different form of a helicopter. It still operated off aerodynamic lift, off blades that were run by 12 motors. Our people discovered much of these technological advances when we went in under Operation Paperclip. We went in and began to bring their scientists out. Even before the end of the war, we sent in people and began to make arrangements to recruit their scientists and their intelligence establishments. Hitler's intelligence establishment, almost intact, was brought out of Germany by the Dulles brothers, Henry Kissinger, and other men who worked on that project to get those people out of there. And those people, the Gehlen Org, was eventually turned into your CIA. You people have no concept that half of the CIA was Nazis and the other half was these stool groups, like the skull and bone groups that Bush came out of. And so Hitler believed he was receiving instructions from these ascended masters, and these 300 Tibetan priests were doing channeling between Hitler and Tibet using Tibetan tarot cards, and they were leaving their bodies, they were doing astral projection, they were just doing all kinds of different things. The ascended masters are those demigods, those people who have evolved past humanity. And they've evolved so far out there that they're no longer operating in this plane. They're just out there. They operate in a whole new level, a whole plane of existence that we haven't evolved to yet, okay?
She said they are Pleiadians, and they have brought you here to do something. And you are ultimately going to be a emissary, was the word, an emissary for them. They're going to channel through you. They're going to use you, and they will speak through you.
She said 20 minutes been used as a channel. So they, again, the spirit entered into him. And the spirit said that he was a spirit counselor that could give him the information that he was looking for. So I said to George, he was sitting next to me, he said, "Isn't it amazing?" He said, "If you think that's amazing, wait," he says, "until the spirits impersonate one of the departed people that you know personally, like an uncle or a brother or a sister or something like that." Says that is unique.
At first, when I first saw these things, I thought it was a hologram, but the light reflecting off of these or emanating from these objects reflected on the clouds above them. At this point, I today do not know what it was in fact that we saw, but when we got back to the hotel, the motel that night, Paul said that he, about a half hour, 45 minutes, something like that, after he fell asleep, he woke up totally awake, and something picked him up, actually picked him up and set him up in bed involuntarily. And the moment he sat up, a light came on over his head like a little dim night light. And he looked up to see an alien's face with the typical alien's face with the bubble eyes, but it was glowing and you could see through it. You could see the ceiling through it as if it were a hologram of some kind.
But it was glowing and you could see through it. You could see the ceiling through it as if it were a hologram of some kind.
In fact, Hynek, even more interestingly, was a government researcher for the US government under a project called Blue Book. The US government has investigated UFOs for over 40 years in different projects. And he found that, you know, the majority could be explained naturally or as either man-made phenomena, but he said there was a mysterious element that defied naturalistic explanation. These craft have been seen to change shapes. They defy the laws of physics. You know, American fighter pilots have gone up, seen these balls of light and shot at them, and they've disappeared before their eyes. They've disappeared off radar screens.
Heineken is his name?
Hynek.
Hynek recognized that what they were seeing was very likely not a nuts and bolts physical
That's right.
object.
Okay. Yeah. People that claim these abduction experiences say that little gray entities enter their room in the middle of the night and they see them pass through the walls.
I'm going to introduce a man who says there are more things between heaven and hell than any of us have accepted, and I have the witnesses and the documents to prove it. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Stephen Greer.
We can establish through this testimony that these objects of extraterrestrial origin have been tracked on radar going thousands of miles per hour, stopping and making right-hand turns. That they use anti-gravity propulsion systems, which we have already figured out how they work in classified projects in the United States, Great Britain, and elsewhere. That these objects have landed on terra firma, at times have been disabled, and have been retrieved specifically by teams within the United States, that extraterrestrial life forms have been retrieved, and their vehicles have been taken and studied thoroughly for at least 50 years.
Care how free you think you are and what you can do, you do something this government doesn't want. They'll plant dope on you, they'll find something in your hotel room, they will do something and you'll be taken off, or like usually if you're a researcher, you'll just disappear and no one will know where you are and nobody wants to talk about it. I'm saying we better wake up and find out we're in trouble.
Her little pastime was calling up, supposedly filling the sky with UFOs and watching everybody's excitement. And some of the most outstanding sightings were in the early 70s in Ohio. And she used to laugh about it because she'd be standing in a circle out in the field somewhere calling up demons. And that's all they were angels of light playing games in the sky. Remember, a demon. Get the little spooky picture. There are a fallen angel, an unclean spirit. They can assume any form or go into anything. But they can assume forms, including spacemen or solid objects like flying saucers or so on. That's why when they appear on the radar scope and a jet gets up there, they vanish right in front of the pilot's eyes because they're nothing but a spirit.
And then, of course, their plans to create a mock alien invasion. I have talked briefly on the radio for Prophecy Club about the flying saucers. Somebody very high up in the New World Order who was brought to Christ by a close friend of mine has talked about piloting the flying saucers. Yes, the United States government has flying saucers. He considered that the beings that were co-piloting these flying saucers were aliens. He took a second look and realized these were demons. I could go on. The bottom line is I have concluded that there are no good aliens. The aliens are demons. And we've got a mixture going on of demons and flesh and blood. And we've also got other genetic experiments. I'm just giving you a tiny sampling of how sophisticated this programming really is. Satan has really outdone himself. And they have a program for infiltrating the churches. And anyone who is a legitimate Christian minister is going to be singled out and targeted.
Basically, the consensus of opinion of these guys is there are two kinds of UFOs. There are top secret government craft, and there are satanic manifestations, demonic. Okay.
Now, I have since come to believe that the extraterrestrial portion of all of this is nonsense, but that the technology is real, is real. I believe that many of us were shown these documents over the years so that later we would talk about it. I mean, how can you keep the existence of extraterrestrials, if they were real, a secret? And how could anyone keep quiet knowing that they had seen documentation, official government documents, labeled top secret, that expressed that these extraterrestrials were real and had visited this earth? I wanted to know just how true all of this was, and I began a program of research to find out if extraterrestrials were real. What I discovered was amazing. What I discovered, ladies and gentlemen, is that there has been a plan in existence since about 1917, and probably before that, to create an artificial extraterrestrial threat to this earth in order to create a one-world totalitarian socialist government. Experiments have been proposed to test the credibility of an out-of-our-world invasion threat. And it continues on another page. Nevertheless, an effective political substitute for war would require alternate enemies, some of which might seem equally far-fetched in the context of the current war system. It may be, for instance, that gross pollution of the environment can eventually replace the possibility of mass destruction by nuclear weapons as the principal substitute for war. Are you beginning to get the message, folks?
I know for a fact that the plan is to make all of us feel totally helpless, that what's happening is beyond our realm to affect because we've been taken over by aliens, that our Independence Day is dawning. So beware of that. Understand that those criminals have been keeping information and technology from us under their blanket of national security. They are 25 years ahead of us, at least, technologically. Can you imagine what they've got now?
The X-Files is the truth is out there. The truth is out there. I'm going to paraphrase. The truth is in here.
We are here today to disclose the truth about a subject that has been ridiculed and questioned, denied for at least 50 years. The men and women who are on this stage and the some 350 additional military intelligence witnesses to the so-called UFO matter and extraterrestrial intelligence can prove and will prove that we are not alone.
A number of therapists have sent me pictures. This is a common theme. Therapists working with satanically abused people, trying to get their minds and back after all this abuse, and sexually abused people that have been in these mind control projects. And it's a very consistent theme that when these people who've been victims of this, they use a lot of drawing to try to draw out their memories. Again and again, what they draw are people with reptilian eyes. These are actually drawn by a satanically abused person. And these were sent to me with their permission by their therapist. Again, Roman Polanski, was talking from knowledge, shall I put it, when he made that film Rosemary's Baby in the 60s with Mia Farrow. And for anyone who doesn't know about that, if you can get hold of a copy, it's worth watching. Mia Farrow is pulled in unknowingly because they want her to interbreed with one of these non-human entities to give birth to a child of the bloodline. And this satanic group get hold of her and they put her under mind control and they impregnate her and stuff. And towards the end of the film, when she starts to realize what's going on, she goes into this apartment where it all went on, her memories start to come back, and she sees the baby she gave birth to in a non-conscious state, and you have a quick flash of it in the movie, and it's a reptilian baby with reptilian eyes. Well, Polanski should know, let's put it that way.
You know, you read in the Bible that, we're all gonna land in a lake of fire and this and that. So that's baloney. Beside that, he said, spirits now, even spirits, they have the capacity now to outlive fire. He says, you don't believe it? Go to India or some of those countries where they have firewalkers. And it's done by the power of demon spirits. These people are energized by demon spirits, so they can walk on those hot coals without burning themselves.
ตอนตะปีนะจังดังมื้อตาเวเปิ้งหมดอ้อๆๆๆคามบาดโอ้ Khơi thế?
Bà lô.
You were both in Skull and Bones, the secret society.
And during the initiation rites, you could hear strange cries and whispers coming from the Skull and Bones tomb.
Despite a lifetime of attempts to get inside, the best Rosenbaum could do was hide out on the ledge of a nearby building a few years ago to videotape a nocturnal initiation ceremony in the tomb's courtyard.
The initiates are told that they are superior beings and are part of a privileged elite who use war, terror, and famine to control Earth's human population.
It's so secret we can't talk about it.
What does that mean for America?
War, terror.
To control Earth's human population.
Hopefully, my health will allow me to keep going until we win the battle against these satanic forces that have come across upon our nation and the world.
If he went now, he'd just be in the way. And I know it would, because, you know, you'd have to take all the Secret Service people. You'd have to take up all these helicopters that could be otherwise out there delivering supplies. And I think it's the wise decision now to send Secretary Powell and Governor Bush and the FEMA director and whoever else went, and let them look, make reports, and then provide the help that's necessary. It might be that sometime in the next couple.
Then I said the next thing was, who is going to be the next president? Now, this is 2 years before he became president.
Right.
They said Jimmy Carter, and I said, Jimmy who? They said, well, he's the Democratic governor of Georgia, and I said, I've been voting Republican. And Paul Volcker said, son, don't worry about it, we control them both.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They're still planning on, the plan is to get a war started in the Middle East, and they're still planning on using a neutron bomb, or one of the bombs that they've got developed, on Israel, mm-hmm. and that's to begin World War III. They're going to declare an emergency, which are going to shut down everything. Then we're going to come down to the extermination, just like World War II.
We can find meaning and reward by serving some higher purpose than ourselves. A shining purpose, the illumination of 1,000 points of light.
Welcome back to Coast, George Norrie with you, John Rhodes. John, let's talk about these reptilians. In the biblical days, when, you know, they said the devil came, and they, you know, the description is kind of close to some of these reptilians. Is it possible that these demons, these devils, might be the reptilians?
I believe entirely that that might be the case, because we have to see it from their historical point of view. They didn't know the term alien, or they weren't thinking of things that God could have created other than themselves.
These are real. This isn't make-believe. These are attacks that were coming to hurt the American people again.
At this point, I today do not know what it was, in fact, that we saw. But when we got back to the hotel, the motel that night, Paul said that he, about a half hour, 45 minutes, something like that, after he fell asleep, he woke up totally awake, and something picked him up, picked him up and set him up in bed involuntarily. And the moment he sat up, a light came on over his head like a little dim night light. And he looked up to see an alien's face with the typical alien's face with the bubble eyes, but it was glowing and you could see through it. You could see the ceiling through it as if it were a hologram of some kind. And it was glowing, looking at him, and he said it slid across the ceiling, went across the ceiling, hit the wall and came down to where it was even with him sitting in bed. It went through the wall and disappeared. But Ivy, in my room, was laying so that she could see the door, and she said she saw the glowing on the wall, but she couldn't tell what the light was because it wasn't very bright. And she said, but when she opened her eyes to see the glowing of the light in Paul's room, which was the face on the wall, a little red, tiny little red dot of light came through Paul's room and came in and hovered over her.
The band leader says, how long have you fellas been involved with sorcery? And he chalked us a little bit, and I said, exactly what do you mean? Well, he said, you know, what you people are doing, talking to the supposed spirits of the dead. He says, this is silly.
And this man had been at the seance with you.
Yeah, oh yeah.
And he's telling you that it's silly what you've just done.
Because see, my wife, he says, goes to the seances because she gets comfort and she gets something good out of it, good feeling out of it. And she lives for what the spirits, you know, are going to see that the future is going to be like. To me, he says, I can't bother with this stuff. He says, I want power. I go right to the source of power. And he says, how do you think that I became famous the way that I am? Well, I said, you must have had some good luck. Well, he says, there's no such thing as good luck. He says, there's either some power working for you somewhere, or you don't get ahead in this world. Not in my type of occupation. So it went from there. We got talking about spirit worship.
Did it intrigue you? Or did it make you want to find out more about what exactly he was talking about?
Yeah. So he said the supposed spirits of the dead that you're talking with are demon spirits. Your fallen angels. Beautiful beings.
Just set it out, just like
oh,
that.
Yeah.
It didn't make you uneasy when he said they were
well,
just
you know, it shocked you a little bit, you know, something that you first hear mentioned to you. He said, you guys have got a great future ahead of you. Because we've been told, the high priest of our society, secret society, has been told that the master has very special plans for you too.
Now, what did he mean by the master?
Satan. And we were interested to hear more about it. And he told us, he says, look, we worship spirits. We worship Lucifer, Lucifer and all his angels. They're just as beautiful as they did before they were cast out of heaven. He says, there was a misunderstanding in the whole thing, he says, among the inhabitants of the galaxies. And he says, our master was misunderstood.
Your friend, George, took you and Roland to this mansion where people worshipped the demons. Mm-hmm. What was it like there? What kind of people were there?
Well, it was a big surprise for me, as I kind of made up my mind an idea that they were going to be rough-looking characters. But as we entered the place, I was amazed to see that they were all very well-dressed, well-mannered, and that a lot of the people, as we were being introduced to people, were professionals, doctors, attorneys, a lot of business people. And see what they had? They had a praise session to the gods, which is the spirit counselors, which are in charge of legions of spirits.
See what they had? They had a praise session to the gods, which is the spirit counselors, which are in charge of legions of spirits.
Prince of all mortal wisdom, owl of Bohemia, we beseech thee, grant us thy counsel.
So how did you feel when you walked into that room?
I felt that these people had power, and they had a lot of it.
Did that attract you?
Yes and no.
You had mixed feelings about it?
I had mixed feelings about it, yeah. Because to a certain extent, things looked so good and sounded so good to us. People believe that the dead have entered into a higher state of existence than they had when they were alive. Also, that they are in a position and have the capacity to help the living here on Earth. See? And you take, for instance, like Loretta Lynn. She says on national television, and I have the data on it, that I heard it myself, she said that she was made successful in her singing career by a dear friend of hers that was the same age as she and died when she was 18 years of age. And Loretta was trying to get into the singing world, you know, but it would, she says, I had no success at all until one night I was sitting in bed reading a book. And she says, who walks right through the wall but my friend, the spirit of my friend? And she says, Loretta, I'm going to make you a very famous person in singing Western country music, and I will be with you all the time. Trust me. Now, the priest explained that when people believe in this business, they are actually opening themselves to be completely deceived by demon spirits, because it gives the demon spirits an opportunity to impersonate the dead. So, who are they talking to? He says, the friendly demon spirits that have always found over the centuries great delight in impersonating in apparitions, departed loved ones, and persons of great renown.
then the medium said, we have a very special surprise tonight for you people. A spirit will manifest itself openly here in a few minutes. And it's right, it's like a big gust of wind hit the building and right through the wall. And that translucent being seemed to come right out of the wall.
How did you feel right at that moment?
It's almost like my heart stopped a little bit. Okay. You know, very weird feeling. So it was a lady in a beautiful evening gown, swirling. And she said to Mary, my dear sister, you are so wonderful to have asked for me. And Mary fainted and fell right off her chair on the floor. And a couple of guys jumped up and picked her up, and it's been gone. And that was the beginning of it.
That's how you got into it.
Yeah, that's the way I got into it. After a while, you see, there's something interesting about the human mind. You can adjust an awful lot of stuff. You can adjust to a lot of things that you that would terrify you to begin with. After a while, they become common and ordinary.
So you mean contact with the supernatural can become commonplace and ordinary and doesn't bother anybody?
Yeah.
In other words, the more that you do it, you're not uncomfortable.
That's
it's
right.
It's just not an uneasy feeling.
Yeah.
So but how then, did you feel about it?
Then I got that? Into a secret society that worshiped the spirits, you see.
Well, how did, okay, different. Now how is that different from the seance, Roger?
It happens that the seance are not involving in many ways. But when you get into a secret society of spirit worshippers, then, and especially when you're invited there by the direction of the higher-ups in the spirit world, you never get out of there alive. And this is exactly what my friend and I were up against. We didn't know anything about it.
Some claim to be able to see into the future and defy the laws of gravity, while others say they are able to defy death. One says he can actually speak to those who are no longer with us. Tonight, you'll debate and decide who has the power to amaze, shock, and become the phenomenon.
Are you ready?
The time had arrived for us to start trusting the spirits and give the spirits a chance to work for us. And there was a number of gifts that you could choose from. I said, hey, I would like to be able to, for the spirit to instruct me on the numbers and the name of the horses that's going to win, you know, at Belmont or some other racetracks like that, make myself a little money. So the priest says, it'll be given you.
And sure enough, one night I fell into a trance or dreamed the thing. I don't know exactly what happened, but I saw three races that were really gonna pay big.
Literally about a week ago, so I'm driving, I'm daydreaming, and I had the craziest premonition. It was like I stopped, I pulled over, and I wrote it down on a little napkin, and it was about a race. This sense of names, numbers, and I wrote all of the thoughts that I had on a huge piece of paper, which I placed in a plastic container, and I put it into this chest right over here that everybody can see. My prediction for the super late model Dash for Cash will be: third place goes to blue car number 21. Yep. Second place will be red car number 21.
Correct.
And the winner is Scott Jeffarini in car 38. Yeah. Take a look at this, folks. Yeah!
Everything you see on this stage will be happening live. A show like this has never been attempted before. There will be no retakes, no second chances, and absolutely no camera tricks. What's more, our celebrities have not rehearsed with any of our competitors. Carmen, is this true?
That is true, yes.
At stake is $250,000 prize, and tonight, anything could happen. I'm definitely keeping an open mind for our first potential phenomenon. He's a 28-year-old who hopes to make an extraordinary connection with two of our celebrities. Meet Ehud Segev.
Since I was a very young boy, I was always so intrigued by the supernatural. The strongest power we have, maybe that's the sixth sense, the hidden sixth sense.
When I was 17 years old, I woke up in the middle of the night crying. I had a dream that my brother was killed. And 10 years later, I get this knock on the door.
And there are two guys standing in that door. And they said, your brother was killed. Everything that happens in my life, since the moment he went away, is controlled by him.
I'm not alone anymore. Everywhere I go, I have my brother with me.
The hidden sixth sense is our imagination.
Carmen, did you feel that tiny little touch before?
I did, yes.
Can you please show everybody where you felt it?
My nose.
Show us where.
But to me, that was a very powerful emotional experience talking to her, because she told me things that no one could have known but myself, and she was very accurate. I'm just telling you this because I believe that there is, in point of fact, something going on in the world where, for a lack of a better term, extraterrestrial, alien, if you please. I don't like the word alien because I know what it means. Extraterrestrial or other world intelligences, higher life forms, are somehow or another intermingling with us. I am totally convinced that that's been the case since day one. I have become obviously more convinced now.
I'm from Venus.
I don't think anybody's going to believe that you or anybody else could be from Venus. Could you explain to us how you could be when everybody knows it's uninhabitable?
They think it's uninhabitable because it is not inhabitable by physical life forms. We have bodies of light.
While Leah rambles on with fantastical ideas, she soon compels the audience toward global unity, a message found throughout the New Age movement.
And what occurs here on this planet will affect the rest of the universe. Can you, with all of your different ideas, all of your different races, come together as one planet and one people? We have dedicated millennia upon millennia to this idea. The earlier experiments with Pan and Lemuria and Atlantis were not successful. But this one will be.
And it did not start, this kind of ideas did not start with von Däniken or my friend, some of the other authors like Zachariah Sitchin. There are many good and profoundly great authors writing on this kind of subject, but it didn't start with them. If you go back into the Bible, into the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Hebrew Bible, in Genesis, is just filled with such stories of angels. As a matter of fact, in Genesis 18, there was a story, a very famous story in the Jewish tradition about Abraham was visited by three men. And it says three men come walking up into Abraham's camp, and Abraham went out and met them and asked them to stay for dinner, the scripture says. And the three men said no, they were in a hurry to go somewhere on business, and the scripture says that he insisted that they at least stay for dinner. So they said, all right, but make it quick. So the wife, Sarah, fixed dinner for them. After eating, they thanked him for his hospitality. And the scripture says in Genesis 18 that the three men thanked him, got up, and excused themselves and went off. And it says, this was the Almighty God, the Creator, with two accompanying angels. Now, they looked like men. They sat down and had dinner with you. They got up, they thanked him, and walked off, and this was the Almighty God with two accompanying angels. I don't know, I wasn't there. This is what the scripture says. Then also in Genesis, there is a story of Lot in Sodom and Gomorrah, where some angels came to visit him, and it says the homosexuals in that town, the scripture said, thought that these were handsome, extraordinary, good-looking men. There are other stories in Genesis and in the Bible about angels who forsook their proper dwelling place and took on human form and started messing around with women. And the Bible says, along with many other holy writings of the ancient world, talk about aliens who took on human form, not just in the Hebrew tradition, but many of the ancients had the same kind of stories, where alien life forms, angels if you please, took on human form and began to mess around with women and got them pregnant. This tells me their plumbing worked. All of that frightens me, because there may be some around here, we don't even know who they are. They appear to be men, they appear to be human. And of course the Jewish tradition in Judaism teaches in the Bible that God made us in his image and likeness. The point being in the Hebrew, meaning in your bodily form, the way you are designed, is because the gods look like that. You look like them, they look like you. Why? Because they created you from them. I tend to think that there is a modicum of truth in that. Maybe it's a beautiful story, it tells you something, but I think there might be something more to this story. That being the case, this is why I'm concerned about world government, world religion, and where we are going as a human race. Who is in point of fact in charge on this earth?
There has never existed one culture on the earth that did not recognize the gods
and the gods who were behind the kings and the great gods who were behind all things. Not one culture has ever existed that did not recognize that there were higher forces at work on the earth. There is no doubt in my mind that our government is also very keenly aware. There, even within the Christian and Jewish religion, there is much proof in the Bible of the existence of angels or spirit creatures who are influencing man's destiny. So I have no problem with believing that there is some sort of a extraterrestrial, if you will, intelligence, because just even the knowledge that the ancient Sumerians, for instance, and the Egyptians had about our universe, about the whole concept of the precession of the equinox, how the sun moves backwards in the signs and the different astrological symbols and the astrological terms, and there's just too much occult or hidden knowledge that was known by the ancients that could not have been just intuitive. It had to have been from someone out there who brought the knowledge to us. Mm-hmm.
Understand, disinformation is deliberate deceit to hide other things, and so there's so much of that, and some of it is surprisingly well sponsored disinformation.
I'm going to sum up this talk and mention an overview of the alien agenda. The alien agenda is really decimate the planet to take the remaining human subjects as slaves, and the aliens would use this planet for their own means.
My question I'd like to ask is this: if the aliens have a 1,200 IQ, can speak all these languages, and are so powerful, what prevents them from just taking over?
Well, that's a good question. We are an alien species to them, and our germs have a tendency to kill them. They're also a dying race, and they're in far worse condition than anybody with the worst case of terminal cancer. They are in need of us to some degree.
And some of it is surprisingly well-sponsored disinformation.
So I think my question is actually to, my question is to Clifford Stone. You said that you had seen aliens on a craft that had crashed. I wondered if you could describe what they looked like.
I could, but it would probably take a whole lot of time. The reason I state that, when I got out in 1989, we had cataloged 57 different species. You have individuals that look very much like you and myself that could walk among us and you wouldn't even notice the difference. The situation is that you have various types of what we normally call grays. We didn't call them grays in the military, but you had at least three types of the grays. You had some that were much taller than we were. The unique thing that I'd like to point out for the most part is that the entities that we did catalog were in fact humanoid. Now this created a situation where the scientific community was trying to figure out why that would be the case, because you would expect that if life evolved on other planets that they would take on some type of other being, so to speak, not necessarily look humanoid or be bipedal such as we are. But apparently we got quite a few of the species out there that are humanoid in appearance. And that creates a question that yet has to be answered by science.
Does that explain some of the visual glances of these things? They seem to just simply disappear. They're gone.
Exactly. I mean, they're appearing out of nowhere and then disappearing right in front of people. And that's why scientists who have no access to grind, they just say that it doesn't make that much sense. And also, if they're just trying to observe us, to take account of what we're doing on Earth, I mean, after a while, after so many months or years or centuries, it kind of gets old. They either would take us over, or they've already discovered all the information they need to know about Earthlings, and so they're just going to take us over or make first contact and just sort of do what they need to do next to endlessly observe us. It doesn't make any sense. It's something where, and also, see, if we have all these sightings, as you know much better than I do, where are they landing? We don't see them getting out to get anything to drink or to eat. We don't see them. They've never tried to make, you know, contact with any large amount of people in a major city. So this doesn't. And also, all the endless medical procedures that the people who have claimed to have been abducted, you know, why the endless medical procedures? I mean, if we're talking about such an advanced race of alien beings, they don't need to do that over and over and over again.
Interesting perspective. Let's talk about some of the facts out there of evidence that may support your conclusion that the UFOs are spiritual phenomena, not physical, like so many other people also believe. What can we pinpoint again?
Well, again, it's something where you cannot have a material or a physical being penetrating the ground, penetrating the water, appearing in front of people, then disappearing instantly, and then also changing colors, sometimes only when they're accelerating, with every color in the spectrum has been recorded. Many UFOs coming and making one UFO breaking apart and then going into multiple UFOs. It doesn't make sense. And then not only just that, but to get into the fact of how far they're traveling and the speed that they would have to travel, and just the other problems with cosmic dust and traveling at the speed of light, and then running into those bits of cosmic dust, the explosions that would be created, the amount of energy that would be consumed and traveling from these distances, just all those kinds of things really scream out that you're dealing with a spiritual phenomenon, not a material or physical phenomenon.
There does seem to be a deception here, because I've always wondered, you know, my gosh, if they're that benevolent, if they're that understanding of humankind, make yourself available.
That's why, you know, some of these other scientists have said that they seem to be trying to set people up to deceive them as if they are aliens, but the facts just say that they can't be that there's something else. It doesn't make any sense, and there's something else, a psychological deception that's going on here. And many of these scientists say, I don't know what it is, but we've concluded that it's got to be that. It's got to be something bigger is going on here than just them trying to show people that, yes, you know, here's a UFO that you're seeing now, we are aliens, that there's got to be something else going on here, on top of the fact that the characteristics of them show that they just cannot be some material or physical craft.
Do you think humans are involved in the deception? I'm losing my voice here. I gotta pop it back.
As far as inside, I think there have been deliberate hoaxes that have been perpetrated. And, you know, it's an interesting statement. I mean, there are many that could be quoted. Gordon Creighton, who I know you know of him, probably, who died in 2003, he made this statement in the British journal Flying Saucer Review. He said, quote, there seems to be no evidence yet that any of these craft or beings originate from outer space.
Thank you.
They appear to have the ability to materialize and dematerialize without a trace. One of the great mysteries of the UFOs isn't seeing them, is trying to figure out where are they when you don't see them. Some people say, well, they're from another galaxy. Most physicists will debunk that for lots of reasons. They seem to pose that way, but for lots of, if they came, you know, if there are that many coming from another galaxy, you think you'd sense the traffic. We'll come to back with some more reasonable explanations, and you're going to discover the two top researchers in the last century, really, is Jacques Vallée, France, and J. Allen Hynek, the American. Now, J. Allen Hynek was head of astronomy at Cornell, and he set out to debunk this nonsense about UFOs, and he became one of the most ardent, competent, balanced researchers in the trade. J. Allen Hynek, he died a few years ago. Both of these respected researchers came to the conclusion that they're not intergalactic. For lots of physics, there are a lot of physics rebuttals to that conjecture. They both argued that these things are demonic. Their term. They've written many, many books. You can check them out. These are not religious people. They're not people with any kind of personal agenda. But they came to the conclusion that these things, on the one hand, and by the way, we take for granted that we strip away the nonsense and the hoaxes. Set that aside. There's tens of thousands of files you have to wallow through. When you cut through all that, there's still a core group, a substantial core group, of real events that need explanation. And so on the one hand, they exhibit physical properties on the one hand. On the other hand, they also violate all physical laws. And so the conclusion from that both J. Allen Hynek and Jacques Vallée and others have come to is that they're hyperdimensional, that somehow they come from another dimension periodically.
But both of them came to the conclusion that these creatures are hyperdimensional. They're not from some other galaxy. They also both concluded they're hostile because they pretend to be something they're not.
Just getting the image.
Franklin, we see a long line, a couple of star-like things, and a lot of things swimming in the foreground. Can you describe what you're seeing?
Well, the long line is a tether, and there's a little bit of debris that kind of flies with us, and it's illuminated by the sun at such low angles. There's a lot of stray light, and it's getting washed out quickly, but Claude is trying to do a good job here adjusting the cameras.
It wasn't until a few years ago that I really started to get into researching all this information, looking at, you know, going through thousands of pages of information about UFOs that just confirmed, you know, what I had already believed about this phenomenon, that I believe the evidence clearly points that they are, in fact, demons.
And, you know, there are others, Brother Michael, who are now beginning to believe that as well. So you're not out there all by yourself anymore. So these demons would make them then spiritual phenomenon, I would take it, right?
Yeah, I think when you look at it, I mean, there's certain characteristics that everyone will agree has been seen and demonstrated also by these UFOs, such as they penetrate the ground, they penetrate water, they disappear in front of people, they appear right in front of people. One person will see a UFO and the person next to them will not see the UFO. They change colors, sometimes only one accelerating. They change shape, they change size. Many people have made the comment that they seem like they're alive almost. And so these are all characteristics of something that's not a physical or material being or construction. It's got to be something that's a spiritual phenomenon with those kinds of characteristics.
somewhere between 1 and 3%, various polls agree, somewhere between 1 and 3% of Americans claim that they have had an abduction experience. That's over 5 million people, or in that neighborhood. Not a few thousand deranged people, not a few, you know, disaffected. This is, we'll talk a little more about this. This is a very, very disturbing phenomenon in the counseling profession. Now, part of the problem of the UFOs is they have some paradoxical behavior. On the one hand, they're seen by multiple competent witnesses. They are plotted on radar, sometimes multiple radars simultaneously. They leave tangible traces on the ground, sometimes radiation, evidence of burning and other things. So they are apparently real in the sense of being physical, on the one hand. There are photographs. Sometimes they show up on photographs, sometimes they don't. But here's the problem. They do, while they seem to be tangible on the one hand, they exhibit behavior that can't possibly be physical. They can go in excess of 6,000 miles per hour without sonic booms. What on earth does that mean? I'd like to know how they do that trick. They've been plotted making right-angle turns at over 16,000 miles an hour. That defies the laws of physics. That's perhaps the most disturbing thing of all, they appear to have the ability to materialize and dematerialize without a trace.
In his book, Secrets of the UFOs, ufologist Don Elkins made the following observation. I have found that some people can achieve the contact phenomenon simply by being hypnotized, and the same general message permeates over 90% of the millions of words received by thousands of people around the world.
No one knows what hypnosis is. No one knows what goes on in the mind. It's an altered state of consciousness like yogis and witch doctors have been practicing. It loosens the normal connection between your spirit and your brain. And of course, if the hypnotist can't control you, make all kinds of suggestions, make you think things are happening that are not happening, make you think you have powers that you don't, experiences that you haven't, even implant memories. Other beings, if there are other minds out there, they could also do the same thing.
Interesting is that there was a huge satanic ritual that was performed on the very spot where Area 51 happened by this Jack Parsons, and in which they had this magical ceremony called Babylon Working, and it was designed by Aleister Crowley, who was a Satanist who called himself the B666.
Yes.
And the purpose of this series of magical ceremonies, which was performed on the spot of Area 51, where it's now located, was to unseal an interdimensional gateway, they said. And so this, they hoped, would allow other entities known as the, quote, old ones, access to our space-time continuum. And this witness said that he saw Jack Parsons rip a hole in space-time there, and he said that something evil flew in. And one other interesting point is that Aleister Crowley, who was a Satanist, who called himself the B666, as I just mentioned, he claimed to have contact with some kind of alien named Lamb. And this Lamb, he drew a picture of this alien that he was in contact, receiving messages from this being. And the picture that he drew of this alien, it's a striking resemblance to the common gray ET drawing. And obviously they have the secret base there where advanced aircraft is being tested. And so it's not one or the other, it's actually both. And what's interesting is this fellow Jack Parsons, who was the main person involved in the satanic ritual, he was involved in creating some of the most advanced technological stuff that we have right now in rocket propulsion systems. He was even involved with a lot of stuff that NASA does. They even named a crater on the moon It's called the Parsons Crater. It was named after Jack Parsons.
Right.
So you see all the connections here.
You know, I've long believed that if there is satanic activity on this planet, and I believe there is, if they are in constant communication with these demons, or even if they conjure them up, Brother Michael, is it possible they do with their rituals and things like that?
Chief advisor to Queen Elizabeth I, Sir John Dee, he was a Kabbalistic black magician. He had gone to the continent and learned from the top Jewish Kabbalists black magic, and he was the chief advisor in the British Empire, and he created Enochian magic and the Enochian language, which the Illuminati, which are hiding behind the Jehovah's Witness headquarters, they use Enochian rituals. Sir John Dee conjured up demons or angels, okay, with his black magic. The beings that he conjured up, there were pictures drawn of them, and they look identical to what we call gray aliens. Okay, I tell you something. And then I visit with debriefing people that came out of high levels of the Illuminati, and these different types of aliens are participating in Illuminati rituals.
East of the Rockies, you're on the air, and your voice was immediately replaced by the operator saying your party has not connected.
As you can now tell, I don't screen calls. So
right. What
happened, obviously, was that I answered the phone just at the very instant that you had been ringing as long as they were going to let you ring.
Yeah.
And so that occurs, obviously, sometimes I go to a line and it's dead and nobody's there, and that's what's happened. You know, we just were on the cusp there. Anyway, I'm glad you made it back through.
Yeah, you got all my paranoia buttons running. I always get very nervous when I call you. I'm Brian. I hung up on you last week.
Oh, I see.
And I just figured, damn the torpedoes. I'll just do this and let the chips fall where they will.
All right.
Everybody, I am the Area 51 caller. That's my statement, and let you or whatever tear it apart.
You claim you're the Area 51
caller? I am the man.
How do you account for the fact, Area 51 caller,
okay,
that part of the way through your spiel, the satellite went down?
I have no idea, and it scared the heebie-jeebies out of me that night. I've called a number of times on your specialty line nights doing different, you know, kind of wacky characters, and I didn't know what you wanted me to do. I knew it was very difficult for me to prove to you, but I just thank you for your patience in dealing with me up to this time. All right.
Perhaps we need some outside universal threat. I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat from outside this world. And yet, I ask you, is not an alien force already among us? What could be more alien to the universal aspirations of our peoples than war?
That her mind may be opened to her. We bind all the powers of darkness, don't you worry. Who are you? Who are you? The Keeper? Rebecca? Rebecca, Keeper, get out of the way. I command you to stay out of the way. Rebecca?
Yes?
Say, I, Rebecca.
I, Rebecca.
Want love. Stay out of the way, Keeper. Stay out of the way.
I want love.
I want out.
I want out.
Say, I put my trust.
I put my trust.
In God.
In God.
In God. Stay out of the way, Keeper.
God.
So what they're doing in effect is using the secret society network they've set up to manipulate these bodies into power, but in doing so they're putting themselves into power because they're controlling the mental and emotional processes of these vehicles. There are many different kinds of entities that do not have a human form that operate just outside of human sight, and history has recorded them as demons and all this stuff. But the reptilian part of it seems to be very significant to the controlling systems on the planet today.
Today, there's a lot of genetic experiments and the Nephilim being created that are hybrids, and this is a very important part of what the Illuminati is doing. And they have been intermarrying with what the public calls aliens. So that these people aren't human as we would know human. They've been pretty thoroughly demonized. The bottom line is I have concluded that there are no good aliens. The aliens are demons, and we've got a mixture going on of demons and flesh and blood, and we've also got other genetic experiments.
They have a vibrational sympathy with that which interbred with them. And this doesn't have to be physical interbreeding either.
Remember, a demon, get the little spooky picture. They are a fallen angel, an unclean spirit. They can assume any form or go into anything.
I have concluded that there are no good aliens. The aliens are demons.
We can establish through this testimony that these objects of extraterrestrial origin have been tracked on radar going thousands of miles per hour, stopping and making right-hand turns. That they use anti-gravity propulsion systems, which we have already figured out how they work. That extraterrestrial life forms have been retrieved and their vehicles have been taken and studied thoroughly for at least 50 years.
Nature to want to believe in some race of benevolent space brothers that will come and save us from ourselves. But it's not logical, and you can't make it work any way you look at it.
This grand plan is going to take people. People are going to eat the stuff, because it says spirits, demon spirits, will declare themselves to be inhabitants of far distant planets in the galaxies, that are coming to warn the inhabitants of planet Earth of the impending destruction of the planet unless something seriously proper is done to avoid it.
Some might call it a power lunch, but it sounded more like a reunion of brothers.
The Illuminati were to obtain control of the press and all other agencies which distribute information to the public. News and information was to be slanted so the goyims would come to believe that a one world government is the only solution to our many and varied problems. Their plot, their plan, their conspiracy remains invisible.
The whole agenda is to create a one world government where everybody has an RFID chip implanted in them. All money is to be in those chips, right? There'll be no more cash. And this is getting me straight from Rockefeller himself. This is what they want to accomplish.
Is he will give you 666.
Behind them is a cult of evil, which seeks to harm the innocent and thrives on human suffering. Evil has found a willing servant.
Make a list of hypotheses. This is obviously not, you know, not a natural phenomenon, and the extraterrestrial explanation seemed to be the best one. Why shouldn't we know that there's got to be life throughout the universe, so why shouldn't it be able to come here, especially since there must be civilizations there that are, you know, thousands if not millions of years ahead of us. But then as you get more and more data, you realize that's not what the witnesses are describing. What the witnesses are describing is something that, in many cases, comes out of nowhere, disappears into nowhere. There are cases of objects becoming transparent on the spot, physical objects, material objects. And I have no question that people have said, well, Valet doesn't believe this is physical. Well, of course it is physical. It's material at some times. But it can also change shape. It can also merge with other objects, and it can also disappear on the spot. Well, if it does that, then it could be from anywhere, anytime.
Always try to, you know, to discredit the old legends, trying to say, no, these people were crazy, they thought everything was possible. But now we have the videos, and that's the big difference. Could you believe there are videos now of probably angels in the sky?
And then I started looking at some of the things that didn't fit. And one of the things that you know, I had to ask is, when did this actually start? Every UFO book starts with, you know, on June 24, 1947, Kenneth Arnold saw something about Ukraine and so on. Well, that's not really true. I mean, we have data from the 30s and the 20s and from 1896 and 1897 all over the United States, and then you can go back in history. And many people don't want to hear that. They want to hear that this is, you know, if you follow the first level extraterrestrial theory, then ETs, you know, discovered us when the atom bomb went off and they came here to study us. Well, that's not what the data says. So when did it start? And I found an enormous wealth of data going back to medieval times and even before. Of course, as you go back in history, you lose the cultural context and it's harder to understand the data. But in medieval times, there were records, especially the records of the church, that were kept very, very carefully about strange phenomena. You know, the skeptics are always saying, well, give us your best case and we'll take it apart. There is no such thing as one best case in any field. You have to look at an accumulation of cases and look for patterns, and then that's how the phenomenon reveals itself to you.
And for a long period of time, or for a period of time, I believed it was extraterrestrial. I now believe it is interdimensional, the phenomena. In other words, we're looking at so-called spirit beings from another dimension. And I back this up in the new book by equating it to ancient manuscripts where these beings manifested to human beings and what their reactions were, and then comparing it to reactions present day of people who have had encounters, and the similarities are striking. Because first of all, you say to yourself, why would let's say anyone deliberately crash saucers in Roswell, New Mexico, and then allow the bodies to be retrieved? What are these bodies, in fact? And this, it took me a long time to figure this out. And this is a theory, okay? There's a difference between the graves, the little guys, right, that we see that have now been enculturated with the big black slanted eyes that are about 4 feet tall. All right, those, let's just call them the graves, because pretty much everyone knows them as graves. But there's another creature which people and abductees talk about that they see on board the ships, and these are tall beings, and they assume different forms. Sometimes they can appear as reptilian, other times they can appear as insectoid, other times they can appear as Nordic. In other words, in my opinion, they're shapeshifters. Now, why would I say that? What backs it up? There's a scripture, once again, from our spiritual handbook, which says that basically fallen angels can appear as angels of light if they so choose.
Okay.
They can appear as angels of light if they so choose. That's a shapeshifter. But it shapeshifts. It can appear as whatever it wants to appear. Insectoid, reptilian. Who knows what the thing really looks like? In my opinion, it's probably a reptilian. Apparently, there was some sort of a confrontation. There was some sort of a war between these beings. Sides were drawn up. And we're kind of like, we're almost like cannon fodder in a way. It's unseen war, which is happening in another dimension all around us that we don't see. So my point is this: what if the grays are nothing more than some sort of a biological suit that enables the demons, let's say, to interface in this dimension? That's what I think the grays are. That's why they're expendable. I'm thinking, I wonder if there's some sort of like a biological clone or some sort of a, you know, a body, if you will, that these demons can interface, inhabit, and then, of course, move about in this three-dimensional time-space continuum. Go back and to read the Book of Enoch, which, by the way, is found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, it amplifies the mischief that these fallen angels got into in and around the time of Genesis 6, which is why it was a global flood, because the Nephilim were on the earth, and these guys were all over the earth. And some of these skeletons were that have been unearthed specifically in Turkey were over 30 feet tall. As we pushed west in Ohio and different places, they found mounds, and they would do primitive archaeological digs. And this is documented. I'm not making this stuff up. They found skeletons, oftentimes, that reached over 9 feet in length with six fingers, six toes, and red hair.
Now, one of the great mysteries of the West is what happened to these giants? There was nearly 60 skeletons brought out of this cave, but today they're nowhere to be found. Is it that there is some kind of archaeological cover-up that has occurred here?
The main point is that that term is used of angels, fallen angels. And the offspring of those fallen angels with human women has produced a hybrid called a Nephilim. In the Hebrew, the term means the fallen ones. Also, the term is gigantes, which doesn't mean giants, it means earthborn. There was a gene pool problem on the planet Earth.
Is that where the Bible then says that Noah was perfect? He wasn't perfect as a sin.
His generations, verse 9. He was perfect in his generations.
His
word
DNA.
Perfect is tamim, meaning physical defects.
You know, when you see something like that, it's overwhelming. It will change your worldview. And is that the coming great deception that ancient manuscripts warn us of? Here's a prophecy from 2,000 years ago that what is coming on the earth will be so bizarre that even the elect would be deceived if that were possible.
An object videotaped by many and seen by thousands over several nights in the Arizona sky in 1997.
Major sighting here.
I believe that many of us were shown these documents over the years so that later we would talk about it. I mean, how can you keep the existence of extraterrestrials, if they were real, a secret? And how could anyone keep quiet knowing that they had seen documentation, official government documents labeled top secret, that expressed that these extraterrestrials were real and had visited this earth? I wanted to know just how true all of this was, and I began a program of research to find out if extraterrestrials were real. What I discovered was amazing. What I discovered, ladies and gentlemen, is that there has been a plan in existence to create an artificial extraterrestrial threat to this earth in order to create a one-world totalitarian socialist government. All the bombardment of the public with movies about flying saucers in the 50s, right after the United Nations Treaty was signed and the UN Participation Act was pushed through Congress, and all of the incidents since that have convinced the majority of the American people that flying saucers are real and extraterrestrials exist, and that flying saucers are from an extraterrestrial origin. This is being promulgated in many ways, by television commercials, in the movies, in the newspapers, by creating incidents either real or imagined.
I mean, how can a nuts and bolts spacecraft, you know, two objects that are supposed to be made of metallic steel, fly into each other at thousands of kilometers an hour, become one object and then fly off in another direction?
He says the UFOs do not seem to exist as tangible manufactured objects. They do not conform to the natural laws of our environment. They seem to be nothing more than transmogrifications tailoring themselves to our abilities to understand. The thousands of contacts with the entities indicate that they are liars and put-on artists. The UFO manifestations seem to be, by and large, merely minor variations of the old-age demonological phenomenon.
Again, the researchers will show you that the messages being received
are deceptive in nature. They will tell you things like, well, you know, we've come from Venus or Mars in the 60s. That was the messages. Well, we now know that's impossible. Now they say they come from Sirius or Orion or Zeta Reticuli or somewhere far off, where we can't test those claims. And that's the problem. And some of the stories they've told us like that, we know to be demonstrably not true. And if someone comes to you, Chris, and tells you a story and does all these things and says, I'm here to help you, but then does brutal things to you and then lies to you, then I don't think trust is a good place to start.
There is no evidence, I wish to emphasize, that these life forms from elsewhere are hostile towards us.
Implement a plan to bring about a one-world government than to create the possibility in the minds of the people of the world that we are being threatened from some other species, from some other planet, and do it in a way that if anybody questions it or challenged it or wants to talk about it publicly, that they are ridiculed.
My mind balked at the idea of believing that maybe all of my friends and all the bloods, innocent blood spilled by all my friends, and they had died at the hands, you know, and the altar of corporate greed by a bunch of occultists.
Because people have asked me in the past, quite rightly, I understand it, why would someone give their life to this conspiracy, this global takeover, in 1500 or 1650 or 1820, when they knew they were never going to be around to actually see it happen, which is what they're trying to do now, playing the cards they're playing now. The answer to that is they were just vehicles. These entities are the common force passing through history.
In other words, demons can inhabit a person. Then you also must know that demons can and do inhabit inanimate objects. I've seen it happen over and over again.
凌晨3:22，一个直径1米多的光球从空中落到了洛阳镇欧凯电气有限公司厂门里侧。落到地面后，这个光球就不停地抖动。约45秒钟后，抖动加剧，并开始变形。长出圆形的四肢后，迅速向厂区移动。
Said you're gonna see guys going into caves looking for looking for people that they're never gonna find. You know, he was laughing about the fact that you have this war on terror. There's no real enemy. He's talking about how by having this war on terror, you can never win it because it's an eternal war, and so you can always keep taking people's liberties away. And I said, how are you gonna convince people that this war is real? He said, but the media can convince everybody it's real. I mean. You know, it's just that you keep talking about things, you keep saying it over and over and over again, and eventually people believe it.
our war on terror begins with Al-Qaeda, but it does not end there.
Multiple intelligence estimates have warned that Al-Qaeda is actively planning attacks on the United States homeland from its safe haven in Pakistan.
The last time you had an actual president was Kennedy.
Ladies and gentlemen,
the very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. And we are, as a people, inherently and historically opposed to secret societies, to secret oaths, and to secret proceedings. Even today, there is little value in ensuring the survival of our nation if our traditions do not survive with it. And there is very grave danger, for we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. But I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people, confident that with your help, man will be what he was born to be, free and independent. I have complete confidence in the response and dedication of our citizens whenever they are fully informed.
When we are successful, and we will be.
And we will be.